Some of this fell here. What should I be? I just need to control and edit this here. Awesome. Thank you. Okay, is that there? Great. Let me set a little timer so don't go too over. Awesome. Well, thank you for having me here. Thanks to all the organizers. It's been a great semester so far. Can't wait to see what happens as we go. Okay, so about me, the first thing I tell people when I give a talk is I'm a person who stutters. I feel more comfortable saying that, and I hope you get more comfortable hearing it. Okay, I was born in Dallas. This is evidence of that. In the 10-minute talk, the next relevant thing is that I obtained my PhD in computer science at Yale, where I was advised by Amin Karbassi and Dan Spielman. This is a picture of us, so you know that we were at some point in the same room at the same time. My research interests while I was at Yale and also more broadly here are in discrete and continuous optimization. So modular optimization, continuous extensions, stochastic optimization. It was in linear algebra, randomized numerical, and aspects that touched on functional analysis. And finally, discrepancy theory, which can be most well explained as balancing high dimensional vectors. Now, my dissertation title was Algorithmic Advances for the Design and Analysis of Randomized Control Trials. And in my dissertation, I focused on three major problems. The first was how to balance covariates in randomized control trials. The second was variance estimation. And the third was the so-called bipartite experiments. I'm going to briefly discuss all three of these here. I've given talks on one of these, and I'll be giving talks on some of the later ones later. So I'm just going to try to sample what I've been working on. Now, the overall goal is to use sophisticated algorithmic techniques to better address some fundamental problems that come up in randomized experiments. And the sort of lofty goal that I'd like to aim for is to provide better finite sample analysis and understanding of experimental methodologies. So I'm going to show a problem and a picture that I've drawn, and the questions, what we're trying to do, kind of our results, and the techniques, and actually kind of give you a flavor of what I've been working on. Okay, so the first problem is balancing covariates. So let's suppose I have n people in my randomized study here. I want to split them up into two groups, into treatment and control. Now, one way to do this is to randomly and independently assign them to treatment and control, as I've done here. But we can usually measure things about the people before we do this. We can measure their age, their weight, their height, lots of types of things. So what could have like gone wrong? And I use wrong in scare quotes here. That's kind of a normative thing. But what could have happened when I randomized is all of the older people got into the test group and all the younger people got into the control group. Or maybe I've made some even worse error now in my randomization. What could have happened is all the men appeared in test and all the women appeared in control. So, you know, if there's enough things you can measure about people, and by enough, I mean relative to the number of people, if you randomly and independently split them up into groups, there will be imbalances. And this may be a good thing or it may be a bad thing, but we have to address that. And addressing that is called covariate balancing. And our main, you know, thought was that this looks a lot like a randomized vector balancing problem. So the questions are, what's the inherent trade-off that exists when balancing covariates between treatment groups? When do you want to have a balance? When might you want to have more randomness? And given this trade-off, how can we navigate it? So our main results, first is a formalization of what we call the robustness balance trade-off, which is, you know, we view as a randomized vector balancing problem. And given the formalization of this trade-off, we design or construct rather a new style of experimental design to near optimally navigate this trade-off. Now, the techniques we use are linear algebra and some discrepancy theory, although I should add that for the version that's on archive now, you don't have to know any discrepancy theory in order to understand the results that we have. And shameless plug is I'm going to be talking about this for much longer on Tuesday at 3:30 at the workshop. The next problem I've been working on is variance estimation. So we have a random experiment. Who we give treatment and control to is random, and so our estimator of the effect is also random. This is, you know, a sketch of its distribution. It looks kind of normal here. Now we know that the effect of the estimator, or for reasonable ones, is going to be unbiased. So it's centered around the true treatment effect. But you might ask, what is the variance of my estimator of the treatment effect? And knowing its variance is very important because we use it to construct confidence intervals like those, you know, based on normal approximations. Now, if we could run our experiment many, many times, we could have all these different samples of the estimator of the treatment effect, compute the empirical variance, and we'd be done. But this is a randomized experiment, and so we have only one experiment that we can run. We only see one realization of that estimator. From one realization, we have to estimate the variance. And there's many ways to do this. There are a couple ways of doing this for very particular types of experimental designs and estimators. But it wasn't super well known how to do this for sort of very general broad classes of designs and estimators. So our question was, how can we estimate the variance of a treatment effect estimator under complex designs and interference? By interference here, I mean that the treatment that I receive affects your outcomes. Our results are first, a characterization of the estimable variance bounds and algorithms for selecting amongst the least conservative variance bounds. And I'll say that knowing bounds on the variance is the way to estimate the variance in situations like these. And the techniques we use here are linear algebra. You have to, you know, manipulate some quadratic equations. These are the variance bounds, and you have to recognize those as matrices. And we also require some convex programming in order to design these types of algorithms that we're working with. Okay, now the experiments we've been talking about so far that we typically talk about are ones where some unit receives treatment and we measure outcomes on that unit. So it's one and the same. But in the bipartite framework, there are units that you can treat and units that you measure outcomes on. So here I've listed power plants. I've listed hospitals nearby. So I may want to treat power plants with some possible pollution prevention plan. And I want to measure the outcomes of the intake of patients at the hospitals who have some type of lung disease or something like this. So here, the units that we treat are distinct from those on which we measure outcomes, and they're connected by a bipartite graph. Okay, so the authors that originally proposed this framework, they make no assumptions whatsoever on the types of responses that the outcome units can have, but they make strong assumptions that the bipartite graph is essentially a union of small disconnected components. So the question that we aim to ask was, how to develop estimators and designs for bipartite experiments under weaker assumptions on the graph, so there can be more overlapping structure there, but stronger assumptions on the responses of these people. You need to do one of these two things. So you can't have it both ways. And in some settings, it is more natural to have a sort of, you know, that more things are related, but you're willing to make, you know, some kind of assumptions on what the responses are. Our results is a new style of effect estimators under the linear exposure response assumption. There's a new style of variance estimators that we derived. We show that surprisingly they're unbiased here, and we use them to obtain asymptotically valid confidence intervals. And we propose a cluster-based design here. You should cluster these treatment units here in a very particular way rather than treating them all independently. And that's based on weighted correlation clustering. So again, the techniques were linear algebra and various clustering algorithms. So here at Simons, I would like to plan to continue some of this work. I want to investigate vector balancing, but in the online setting. I'd like to keep investigating estimation under structured interference. But I also like to begin some new work. I want to understand and engage with statistical approaches and the theory underpinning observational studies. That I know less well. I'd like to understand that more. And the question that I'm trying to answer for myself is, where can algorithmic techniques improve our understanding and analyses of observational studies? So I'm interested in matching these doubly robust estimators, instrumental variables, and stuff like this. If you think there's some good, you know, match, or you'd like to tell me a lot of stuff that I don't know now, which is a lot, I'd love to talk. That's all I have to say. You can find me in this office, room 318, and I'm currently on the postdoc job market. Thank you.
Questions? What is covariate balancing? Are there only results in the static setting? Because you mentioned that you are thinking about the online setting, but online setting dynamically, you want to. And then are there any results that look at that problem in dynamics?
So the question was about the current results in the dynamic in the online setting that I referred to here, the vector balancing problem. Two thoughts. First, people thought for a long time of how to assign treatment and control of randomized experiments and how to do covariate balancing. I think we have a new, you know, kind of principles, like formulation of what that is and what those trade-offs actually are. So there does exist work, you know, going back to like the 70s and stuff, how we should, but it's not the formulation that we like have. Now, there is discrepancy theory, which is concerned with one assignment that balances two groups. Just split them up one time. There is a lot of cool, very cool recent work in that direction, but it is very different from what we've been doing, which is sort of like a randomized vector balancing problem. So there's lots of open work. There has been work on it, but not specifically on the, you know, kind of randomized version that we've been looking at. But I can tell you more about the recent discrepancy stuff off one.
So we take more questions at the break. Thanks, Chris. Next, we are tracking on multi-agent team.